This video is sponsored by Brilliant.
Duke University announced it had found the holy grail of cancer research.
Dr. Potti's research promised the right drug right now.
But a report now says Dr. Potti manipulated data to match his theory.
By falsifying data sets that clinical trials at Duke were based on.
It may end up being one of the biggest medical research frauds ever.
In 2006, a revolution emerged that held the power to reshape medicine forever. Hailed as the holy grail of cancer research, this invention promised to deliver the most effective cancer treatments for every patient. The scientific community was excited and clinical trials were kicked off, enrolling people all across the US. The trial started and patients were treated, until it turned out that it was all a lie. This is the story of one man who deceived the world, courageous scientists who tried to stop him, and one of the biggest scandals in modern medicine. The American dream is defined by the belief that everyone in the US has a chance to be successful and happy if they work hard. Over the course of history, numerous individuals have personified this ideal. Among them was Anil Potti. Born in 1972 in Hyderabad, India, Potti always worked hard to reach his goals and relentlessly pursued his aspirations. Determined to become a doctor, he embarked on his journey and graduated from Christian Medical College, Vellore, India in 1995. Potti then moved to the US to first join the North Dakota School of Medicine and then Duke University. Anil Potti had everything going for him. He was enrolled in one of the most prestigious institutions in the world and had the privilege of being mentored by the renowned cancer researcher Joseph Nevins. By working together, they aimed to change cancer research forever. How, you might ask? They aimed to develop a tool that identifies the most effective treatments for cancer patients, an invention that could save millions of lives. Let me explain. Cancer is one of the most deadly diseases worldwide. Every year, 18.1 million people are diagnosed with cancer, and over 10 million lives are lost to this devastating disease. Throughout history, various cancer therapies have been developed and yielded significant advancements in the battle against cancer. In the 19th century, cancer surgeries became feasible. Radiation therapy was developed in 1903, followed by chemotherapy in 1948 and antibody therapy in the 90s. While every new form of therapy is revolutionary on its own, there is one issue. No single therapy can effectively combat all types of cancers, and that will never happen. The reason for this is that cancer is highly diverse. Right now, there are over 200 types of cancer identified with numerous subtypes. It is clear that different types of cancer exhibit different behaviors, but even the same cancer type can be vastly different in two patients. As a consequence, one form of therapy might be effective in one patient, but it might be inefficient or even harmful in another. This is why the concept of personalized medicine emerged. Personalized medicine means that we customize therapies to effectively treat every patient individually. And to do this, we need to understand the patient's cancer as much as possible. Normally, it works like this. We obtain a small piece of the cancer from the patient and isolate cancer cells. Then we employ techniques to examine the behavior of genes within these cells. In simple cases, we analyze the activity of a couple of genes that are known to make a tumor resistant against a certain treatment. If these cells are highly active, then we choose another treatment. However, it's often more complicated, and it's not that a few genes, but a lot of genes impact the success of a treatment. This means that we need to find combinations of genes which are important or not important for certain treatments, and that is complicated to say the least. But Nevins believed in Potti. He believed that Potti can develop a software that analyzes the activity of all genes in a tumor and predicts how a patient will respond to certain drugs. If that worked, it would revolutionize cancer treatments and save numerous lives. So Potti started working. Originally, he was interested in how patients respond to docetaxel, a chemotherapeutic drug. He downloaded gigabytes and gigabytes of data and analyzed hundreds of tumor samples. In his first analysis, he found 50 genes that are highly active in cancers that are sensitive to docetaxel. Based on his findings, he developed a model to predict how other cancer samples will respond to this drug based on the activity of their genes. And surprisingly, he was right, every time. After hearing from Potti's success, Nevins was ecstatic. This could be the revolution they hoped for. So they quickly completed the project, and in 2006, they published their work. It was like something the world has never seen before. Potti's predictions were amazing. They meant that doctors can do a biopsy to isolate tumor cells, analyze the gene activity, and then use Potti's algorithm to determine what treatment to use. Immediately, Potti and his colleagues pushed hard to start clinical trials using his predictions. In 2007 and 2008, three clinical trials were launched to choose the right treatment for lung cancer and leukemia patients. In 2009, Potti and his collaborators proposed a large clinical trial in early-stage lung cancer. They planned to enroll over 1,500 patients and use the method developed by Potti to guide the treatment. At the same time, Nevins and Potti applied for patents and started a company. They were so close to leave a lasting mark on cancer research. But then, one of the trials was cancelled. Then, another and another. All clinical trials were suspended. The company never saw the light of day. Something happened. But what? Even before Nevins and Potti launched their clinical trials, scientists looked into the models and were alarmed. It all started with Potti's big breakthrough in 2006. Two scientists stumbled upon Potti's predictions. These men were Kevin Coombes and Keith Baggerly. Coombes and Baggerly, both experienced data scientists, were fascinated by Potti's predictions. So they used some of his original data and tried to replicate the results. However, they soon saw something odd. Here and there, the data in the tables was shifted. This could be an honest mistake, but when they took a closer look, it even became weirder. Using Potti's software, they only could verify that 31 genes impact drug sensitivity, not 50. And while some of Potti's predictions seemed to fit, others were wrong. And with that, I mean completely wrong. In fact, they found that Potti's predictions would sometimes not choose the best treatment, but the worst. So they wrote an email to Potti. Potti quickly responded and said there were some errors in his original work, but the new data confirmed his results. Coombes and Baggerly tried to stay polite, but continued asking questions to Potti. At some point, he stopped responding. A major red flag. So they summarized the findings and published them. They gave Potti the benefit of the doubt and concluded that we do not believe that any of these errors we found were intentional. We believe that this situation might be improved by an approach that allows a complete, auditable trail of data handling and statistical analysis. Potti publicly answered that he had revised the data and corrected the errors. He did emphasize, though, that his methodologies were correct and entirely appropriate. For now, Coombes and Baggerly had to wait for further development. But they were not alone in the doubts. Someone else decided to step up. Bradford Paris. Paris was a third-year medical student in Nevins' lab at the time. When he joined Paris' lab, he was thrilled. But after a couple of months, he felt that something is off. Paris had the task to analyze some data using Potti's predictions, but Potti never explained how he actually analyzed his data. Paris realized that other co-workers felt the same. They all published their works without really explaining or even often knowing how Potti analyzes his data. Then he saw something more concerning. Potti's model uses data from real cancer patients to see how they will respond to certain drugs. But predictions tend to be overly optimistic. This is why models are normally verified through a method called cross-validation. In cross-validation, we split our data into two segments, training and validation data. Training data is used to rebuild the model again and again. Once the model is rebuilt, we use this new version of the model to predict the validation data. If the validation data can be predicted well, then we have a good model. Simply put, we try to predict data that we already have. Cross-validation is a very well-established method to see if our predictions are right. However, Paris realized that Potti doesn't use normal cross-validation methods. Potti seemed to raise data that doesn't fit his model. In fact, he reported in one project that over half of all cancer samples were magically removed from a dataset before starting cross-validation. This means that Potti only used data for cross-validation where he knew that it would perfectly fit with his hypothesis. And that's like kicking out all drunk people out of a bar and then concluding that no one drank much that evening. Once Perez has realized this, he talked to Potti and Nevins about his concerns, but they dismissed him. Perez now had to make a choice. Reporting his concerns, challenging powerful political forces, meaning that he, a third-year medical student, might compromise his future career, or staying silent. Perez decided to speak out. He resigned his position at Potti's lab, withdrew his name from publications, and wrote a document about his experience in Potti's laboratory. He sent his document to several high-ranking individuals within the faculty. However, it took several years until it was released to the public. It's hard to say what happened next, but Duke administrators seem to have met up with Potti at some point, but decided not to launch an internal investigation at that point. Duke University would later be criticized for failing to act decisively on Paris' suspicion. But while it took so long to expose the scandal, you know what doesn't take long? Learning science at mass at brilliant.org. With that, welcome to today's sponsor. I'm proud of this segue. Whenever I uncover scientific frauds, I need to refresh my knowledge about statistics. And this is why I joined brilliant.org. Brilliant offers thousands of lessons that provide an immense learning experience in AI, data science, statistics, and more. There are new courses uploaded every month, meaning that you can constantly enjoy new lessons on your favorite subjects. What's the chance of you improving your analytical thinking after you joined Brilliant? You see, that's a conditional probability. Find it all out when learning about statistics and probability. So go to brilliant.org/sciencerely. The first 200 who join will get a 30-day free trial and will get 20% off their annual subscription. So what are you waiting for? Go to brilliant.org/sciencerely and join today. Where was I? Coombes and Baggerly continue their work. Together, they spent over 1,500 hours trying to make sense of Potti's data. And they came to one conclusion. Potti's predictions were wrong. Then came the shock. Coombes and Baggerly heard that Potti planned clinical trials. Once more, Coombes and Baggerly decided to go public. They again published the findings, outlining the flaws of Potti's predictions. This time though, they managed to get more attention. The National Cancer Institute reached out to Duke University, requesting to review the validity of Potti's work. This was the first time the National Cancer Institute wrote Duke University, but it wouldn't be the last time. Over the next months, the National Cancer Institute would re-evaluate Potti's data. Talk about Potti's faulty model, spread. As a response, enrollment in the free clinical trials was suspended, and a committee reviewed Potti's work. Baggerly additionally sent a report with his concerns to Duke University, but Nevins, Potti's mentor, managed to withhold the report from the committee. A few months later, the committee concluded that Potti's predictions are scientifically valid. The evidence was not enough. So in January 2010, the clinical trials resumed. Nevins and Potti still defended their work, wrote emails, and addressed concerns. It seemed that Nevins was still believing in Potti, but now more scientists took action. And in July 2010, 31 data scientists all around the world sent a letter to the director of the National Cancer Institute. They all spoke out against Potti's work. The National Cancer Institute completed its re-evaluation of one of the clinical studies. They raised questions about the research. Duke University suspended the trials for a second time. And then an anonymous whistleblower finally took down Potti, but not in a way you might expect. Paul Goldberg is an editor of the independent newsletter, The Cancer Letter. One day, he received a concise message from an unidentified source. Check Dr. Potti's Rhodes Scholarship. The Rhodes Scholarship is a prestigious award from the University of Oxford. In the past, Potti has listed this scholarship in his CV in order to apply for grants and money. But as Goldberg found out, Potti never received the Rhodes Scholarship. Instead, he received a fellowship from a group of Rhodes Scholars in Australia. Oxford University confirmed that Potti has never been a Rhodes Scholar. And this was the beginning of the end. Duke University reviewed Potti's credentials and put him on administrative leave. While Potti was suspended, Duke officials reported to have found inconsistencies in Potti's data. All clinical trials were terminated, and one work after the other was retracted, including Potti's original work. Several lawsuits were filed against Potti and Duke University on the behalf of the patients. Potti stated that he was not aware that false or improper data was included in the research. The lawsuits were settled in 2015. So what happened then? In the same year, the Office of Research Integrity found that Potti had engaged in research misconduct. Potti neither admitted to or denied this verdict. And then in a weird twist, the North Carolina Medical Board has condemned Potti, but didn't take away his medical license. In fact, Potti applied for a medical license in South Carolina, and that was approved, and he would go on to be a physician. Until this day. Yikes. Potti's mentor, Joseph Nevins, was most likely not directly involved in the fraud. However, he failed to check Potti's data and acted unethically in multiple instances, such as pleading Perez not to speak out or withholding Baggerly's report. But there is also some good news. Bradford Perez, the medical student who risked his career to speak out, later became a doctor, an expert in radiation oncology. First, Perez became a resident at Duke and is today practicing in Florida. His remarkable bravery serves as an inspiring example for others to follow. And then there's Duke University. Duke University has taken steps to rework the quality framework. One factor to the limited regulation of Potti's study is that the institute where he was hosted had its own guidelines separate from the standard protocols at Duke University, and that means that it didn't have to follow so many rules. Still, it is shameful how long it actually took to terminate the clinical trials. But where does it take us with personalized medicine? For every unethical scientist, there are hundreds of hardworking, honest scientists. And since the scandal unfolded, significant progress has been made. Today, cancers that were deemed nearly incurable just 2 decades ago can now be effectively treated with customized medications. Cancer treatments continue to revolutionize medicine, even today. This has been the second scandal that has been uncovered by brave scientists, but there is one person remaining in the shadows.